Title of today's message is, with charity, you can fight until the end. With charity, you can fight until the end. Colossians chapter 3, we're going to look at verse 12 through 15. Colossians chapter 3, verse 12 through 15. The Bible says, put on therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another, and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. And above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also ye are called in one body, and be ye thankful. Pastor Shrive, can you please pray for the message?
Father, once again, we're so thankful for the Word of God. We pray that you'd bless this and open the portals of glory. Speak to our hearts. Well, thank you for it. Thank you for Brother. We ask, Lord, you'd bless him. And we're looking forward to a good message today from heaven above. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. With charity, you can fight until the end. After salvation, many think that it's over. Especially without the right doctrine, you think that once saved, and your life is easy peasy. That's where prosperity gospels come. That's where, easy believism. And that's where people fall into, devil's snare. You think that since you're saved, you could do whatever you want. We hear that all the time. When we go visitation, you knock on door, those who like to criticize what you're doing, they're like, okay, so since you're saved, and if I were to get saved, I could do whatever I want. They're just ignorant and foolish, right? You get saved, and especially if you're saved, knowing that, Jesus Christ died for your sins, through his blood, your sins are washed away. You're a new creature now. You're born again. That is something that you won't say. Funny thing is, though, not a whole lot of Christian will fight until the end. Not a whole lot of Christian will finish the race. Unfortunately, because of the law of average, many of you in this congregation will not fight until the end. How is that possible? Why is that? And I could tell you, and people who's been at our church for a long time can tell you, and I know Pastor Shrive can tell you, people you've seen him 20 years ago, they're no longer here. People you've seen him 10 years ago, they're no longer here. People you've seen him 5 years ago, a year ago, even last week, they're no longer here. Why is that? Because they're losing the battle. Because they're not fighting until the end. Many times, when you first get saved, you're gung-ho. You're very zealous. You want to quit everything that you do and just go out there, just pass out tracts and witness. And we've seen many cases, and those of you who are laughing, it's you. And it was me as well. I mean, literally, I was going to a secular church, and then they were following, this praise and worship, Calvary Chapel type of church. And all you ever did was, sing, kind of like a concert, right? Jump up and down, have a projector up there. All you're doing is singing along, and there's like a 5-minute message, and every Sunday you accept Christ, and you do that over and over. But, by grace of God, I got saved, through the Word of God. And I met Pastor Kim. Before I was saved, but I didn't have the right doctrine. So I met Pastor Kim. That's a whole nother story. And I found out the truth and right doctrine. I found out Dr. Ruckman, right, through, you know, Pastor Kim. And my life was like, it completely changed. I mean, I was going to school at that time. And all I ever wanted to do was just go out there and just witness to people. I remember I would just go to some schools. And I used to live in LA, like in Koreatown. I'll go to schools like on Wilton Boulevard, you know, I'll just go everywhere. And then I'll just go witness to them, right? You know, sometimes you get kicked out because school administrators or vice principal, whoever is like, oh, you can't pass those out. And I thought, you know, those were the great days. However, without charity, it won't last long. Without charity, you will burn out. Without charity, you cannot finish. Without charity, when the devil attacks you, you will fall. You will, you know, sit on your, you know, butt and not move. And you'll just think, oh, man, you just reminisce those days. You know, I was really close to the Lord. But you know why that happened? Because you did not live a balanced life. You know why that happened? Because number one thing, you're trying to do it without charity. And as I said, you know, it's Valentine's Day, you know, especially if you have wife and husband, you know, you should say, you know, appreciation to them. Every day should be Valentine's Day, right? You should say your appreciation and you should live like that every single day. But at least, you know, you could let them know. But just like Mother's Day, right? You appreciate your mom, Father's Day, you know, things that you do. It's just a, you know, reminder. However, you know, as a Christian, you need to look at yourself, right? Where is charity in my life? What is charity to me? You know, according to 2 Timothy 2, 1 through 5, you're a soldier of Jesus Christ, right? So naturally, as a soldier, you're going to fight. Whether you like it or not, you're in a war. You're in a spiritual war. You're enlisted when you accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior. Amen. And Lord is our commander. Then you're constantly fighting. However, some of you don't have a victorious Christian life. You know, Brother Richard's favorite song, Victory in Jesus. How many of you guys are actually enjoying victory day after day? How many of you guys actually know the word victory in your Christian walk? Because for many of you guys, you don't have any victory. I'm going to tell you a definition of charity. And, you know, this is from Dr. Ruckman's theological book, right? Charity in the Bible is God giving his son as an atonement for poor and needy sinners. That includes you and me. Again, charity in the Bible is God giving his son as an atonement for poor and needy sinners. That's God's charity to you and me. As Christians, which I believe almost everyone in this room is, as Christians, we show love to our believers who are in need of time, attention, affection, kindness, money, clothing, fellowship, etc., by giving to meet those needs. When we do it expecting not in return. That is real God-like love. It is charity. How many of you guys show that kind of charity to each other, to your family members, to your husband and wife? Where when you do it expecting nothing in return. Wow. You know, that will blow off, you know, everybody's mind. All this, you know, modern, you know, scholars, modern love, everything. When you do it expecting nothing in return. When you do something for God, do you expect something in return? Like, oh, Lord, I have, you know, house to buy. So I'm going to go to church. I'm going to read your Bible. I'm going to pray. You're giving Lord a condition. Or, Lord, I'm going to pass out track today. So I hope that my bankroll increases. Right? Lord, since I'm going to do this for you, I want you to improve my relationship. you know, everybody's backward. The reason there's so much divorce in this country and throughout the world is people always expect something back. Right? Then, if you always expect something back, your feelings kind of get hurt. Hello. Okay, here's my birthday. Here's your birthday. So I'm giving you this birthday present to you. Say that was like last week. And someone had a birthday, right? Like Josh. And your birthday comes up 2 months later. And then you're waiting and waiting. And you're looking at Josh. Waiting and waiting, right? And you don't get anything. And your feelings are hurt. Your carnal self shows up. And you start gossiping with your family members, you know, with your brothers and sisters, with your mom, with your dad. Can you believe it? I gave this person a present, but they didn't give me a present on my birthday. Wow. Now that's something that some people do go through as a Christian, because you and I, we're of the flesh. So unless, you know, you die to yourself each day, those emotions will come up. Until the day of the rapture, or until you die, you'll always have your flesh, your old nature problems. That's just normal. That's why, because you're saved, doesn't mean it's over. It's a start, especially for Christian. It's constant fight that you have to go through. If you're not fighting every day against your flesh, against your old nature, then you have lost to it already. You're like, I don't remember. Man, what does it mean? You know, when you give into temptation constantly, you're losing to your flesh and your old nature. When you're lazy, when you don't want to listen to the word of God, when you don't want to be changed through preachings, then you are constantly losing the battle. I'll go to the final point in the middle of the sermon, right? So that you have this in your head. Then what is victory? Right? What is victory? As a Christian, you know, you want to win. Not even as a Christian, you want to win. You know, even Dr. Ruckman, until, you know, he went to the Lord, right? He was playing hockey, right? He wants to win, just like everybody else. When you play sports, you want to win. When you play, you know, Scrabble, you want to win. When you play any of those team games, you want to win. That's a human nature. Then, how do you get victory? As Christian, you get victory when trials come in your life, when sufferings come in your life, when heartaches come in your life, you still have joy. When difficult days come, you have joy of salvation. You have joy of the Word of God. You constantly have joy of fellowship. That shows that you have victory. That's why some of you guys are defeated right away. You have no joy in your salvation. You have no joy in the Word of God. And obviously, you have no joy in fellowship amongst the brethren. You have no victory. You're already lost. Think about it. God gives you chance to get right, though. Isn't it amazing? He constantly gives you chance to get right. And you can get right through preaching. That's why many of you guys who's listening as well, when your heart is not committed to change your life for the better, to become a better Christian, to become a better child of God, to become a better witness and testimony, as you listen to preaching so that your life will be changed, if you don't have that kind of mindset or heart, whoever you are, you will lose the battle. It's just simple as that. You and I, we're so weak. We have to deal with our flesh, we have to deal with the world, and we have to deal with the devil. Turn your Bible to 1 Peter chapter 5. 1 Peter chapter 5. People say, in order to win the battle, you need to know the enemy, right? I mean, number one enemy is you yourself. But there's the devil always walking about trying to destroy you. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. Think about it. Devil is always trying to defeat you, attacking you. How are you living your life when devil's in a constant attack mode? If someone's constantly punching you, are you keep on taking it? Doesn't it hurt? I mean, as a spiritually speaking, as a Christian, devils keep on punching you, kicking you, you know, but you don't do anything about it. You're like a vegetable, right? You just let something just hit and you don't do anything. I mean, you should be like a, you know, junkyard dog and fight back, right? You should have some bark, because Bible says what? You know, submit yourself therefore to God, resist the devil and he'll flee from you. I mean, how many of you guys are actually fighting, resisting the devil, right? On a daily basis. And Bible says, devil will flee. You know, certain people will have less temptation. Why? Because they have resisted devil many, many times. Certain people will have more temptation. Why? They don't resist. Right? If a scammer or con artist knows that person A always gets deceived, and person B always, you know, fights back and asks for truth, they're going to constantly go to person A. Which one are you? Are you that person A, where devil loves to get a hold of you? Actually, no. Devil doesn't have to do that. Devil knows where you are always. And devil knows that you will answer him. Devil knows that you'll make him happy. How many of you guys actually on a daily basis resist the devil? How many of you guys actually on a daily basis have victory? The thing is, you constantly lose. Why? Because you don't have charity. You're like, oh, what does that even mean? You know, I don't have charity? You know, I read the Bible, I come to church, you know, I pass a track here and there. You know, I do all this fundamental stuff that I need to do. But why am I losing? Because you don't have charity. You're like, what does it mean? I already told you from the beginning of the message, so you could go back and rewind it over and over and find out. I mean, when you have commitment to the Lord, when you love the Lord without expecting anything back, right? Charity is love in action. When you make a commitment that I love you, Lord, I'm going to keep your commandments until the end, whether you come and take me up there or I die, then you have a chance. Then you could be victorious. You'll follow his word and you'll obey his commandment because you love him. Then you will and you can fight until the end. When you do something out of charity, it lasts, right? When you do something because you're forced to do it, it never lasts, right? You tell your kids, right, or anybody, eat your vegetable, it's good for you. Or else, you know, you get the good old stick. I'm like, okay, I'm gonna eat it, right? However, if you love the person that who told you to eat it, it's a different. I love you, Dad. I love you, Mom. I'm gonna eat it. Sometimes it doesn't taste good, but I love you. I made a commitment that I'm gonna follow and obey your word no matter what, because I love you. How many of you guys have committed yourself to the Lord in that matter? Where you're like, Lord, no matter what happens, you know, I want to, and I commit myself to follow you and keep your word. Why? Because I love you. Man, your life will be changed. The fights and battles that you have with your flesh, the world, and the devil becomes easier and easier. You do this out of love. You do this out of charity. Why is it that many times when people start dating, they do things that they never thought they'll ever do? Obviously, after the marriage, things change, you know, after years pass by. But, you know, before that, you know, they call it, right, burning love or whatever love it is. You know, they'll do some crazy stuff that they'll never think about doing. You know, shout out love in front of everybody, right? You know, buy a, you know, cheesecake at 3 a.m, you know, or do stuff that you normally would never do. Why? Because you love that person. And if you continue to love that person, those difficult, hard things in the sight of other normal, regular people, third party, it's easy for you. You actually have joy in doing it because you're making the person that you love happy. I mean, when was the last time you got joy out of making the Lord happy? Where you're like, man, every time I please the Lord, I'm so happy. Every time and I follow His word, every time when the tests come my way, I rely on the Lord to defeat it. And I know that that makes my Lord smile. That makes my day. But for many of you guys, it's all about, you know, your fleshly things, your lust, your possessions, your money, right? Your relationship. And when those things kind of work out, you're like, wow, I love you, Lord. You know, Lord, you're so good to me. But when tough times come, first thing you do is, why me, Lord? Why me? And you start complaining and complaining and complaining. Not only that, it leads to gossip. Not only that, you destroy yourself, your family, church, everybody. I mean, that's a progression. It's going to go downhill. I mean, if you're in one of those stages, you know, don't wait too long because it's going to happen to you. That's why you have to recognize, man, did I make a commitment to the Lord ever, right? Did I ever, like, make a commitment? Like, Lord, since I love you, no matter what happens, I'm going to follow you and obey your word. Whether it's my family, whether it's my close friend, whether it's anybody, you know, who get in the way, I'm going to follow you. Why? Because I love you. Because you love me first. I mean, when this gets instilled in your heart, willingly, freely, you will have no issues having victory and fighting until the end. A lot of you guys don't have joy in your life. And it's simple. You have no joy because you're being defeated. Simple as that. Like I said, victorious people, no matter how difficult their life is, they have joy of salvation. No matter how painful their life is right now, they have joy of the Word of God. No matter how, you know, it seems like a dead end, you have joy of fellowship as well. Where do you seek your joy? Do you seek your joy from things of the world? I mean, those are very temporary. Right? I mean, do you think, you know, drinking will give you joy? Do you think smoking will give you joy that lasts? Do you think gambling will give you joy that lasts? Do you think immoral relationship will give you last? I mean, those things will just burn up and disappear. And especially as a Christian, as Holy Spirit is in you, you'll be convicted constantly. You will not be happy camper. That's why, you know, some of you guys, I'm not saying you're like that, but at least from your outward appearance and testimony, you're living in that sin. You keep on losing. You know, and whoever ever had to lead ships, right? If one goes astray, man, they feel really heartbroken, right? As pastors and as teachers, you see people and they fall away and keep on losing the battle to the devil. I mean, it's heartbreaking. However, at the end of the day, though, pastors do their job, but it's up to you to change. It's up to you to make commitment. It's up to you to make that commitment to the Lord. That, Lord, I love you, and no matter what happens, I'm going to follow you, and I'm going to obey your word. That's first thing. Then secondly, if you make that commitment, then you have to make a commitment to fight against sin. You told the Lord, Lord, I am committing to you. I will follow every word in the word of God. Then you would have to make commitment to fight against sin. In order to be victorious, you need to know what your weaknesses are. Because that's what devil's gonna attack you, right? Is your weakness lust of flesh? Is it money? Is it the world? Is it your pride? Is it gossiping? There are a number of things that you're weak at. And devil will constantly attack your weakness. That's why the Bible says, abstain from all appearance of evil. Once you get to the stage of debating whether to do it or not, you've already lost. You say, I'm gonna fight against sin 95% of the time. Then when the 5% comes, you start debating. Should I do this or should I do it not? And 99 out of 99 times you're gonna lose. You'll be like, oh man, I don't do 95% of those sins, but I need some of my pleasure. I need some, you know, of my own time, my own break. And then you do it. And that 5% becomes 10%, 15%, 20, 50, and it completely consumes you and ruins you as a Christian. That's why you have to make a commitment. I'm going to fight against sin. But why? Because I love the Lord and I'm going to obey his word. Because he first loved me. I'm going to fight against sin. If you have a tongue problem, right? For some people. I mean, back in the day, you know, someone said, someone's weak to money, someone's weak to lust, and someone's weak to tongues. Why? You know, one of the preachers said, it goes from this. Telegraph, right? That's how messages go. Telephone, right? And telewoman, teleperson. Nowadays, guys talk as much. You know, everybody. Telewoman, teleman, right? And that will completely harm the church. If you have tongue issues, where you can't wait to talk about some other person at the church, where you can't wait to criticize the pastor and pastor's wife, you can't wait to criticize missionaries and missionaries' family and wives, you can't wait to criticize that brother or sister, you have lost the battle. And you're going to continuously lose the battle, and you're going to not only harm yourself and the brethren, you're going to harm the church. So, think about it. Think about your weakness, right? If you love the Lord, you're going to commit yourself to the Lord. If you love your neighbor, your brethren, you're going to commit yourself to your brethren as well. Are you fighting against your sin? Have you made commitment to fight against sin? Maybe you constantly lose to the same sin over and over, whatever it may be, because you never made that commitment. Because you're always, always back in the mind, I am not going to do it, but if I do it, I'm just going to ask the Lord for forgiveness. I'm just going to confess my sin. It's like child is telling father, Dad, I'm going to slap your face here and there. But I'm going to say sorry to you because you're loving father and you're going to forgive me. If I'm looking at that from a third person, man, that boy needs to get, you know what? Not only that, what kind of love is that? Very ungrateful, unthankful child. But however, that's how you and I behave. That's how you and I live our life. We're telling God, God, inevitably I'm going to commit this sin because I'm not perfect. But I'm going to confess. I'm going to turn away from it. I know you're going to forgive me. Man, that is very, very bad attitude that you have. That's why you have to commit to fight against sin 100% of you, 100%. 1 to 100, A to Z, whatever it is, completeness. You have to commit to the Lord 100% that, Lord, I'm going to fight against sin, especially weaknesses, those sins that has haunted me forever. I'm going to fight. No? Bible has the answer again. Abstain from all appearance of evil. Stay away from it. Especially young people, you have to stay away from it. That's why you get into trouble. That's why you have to make commitments. You have to make a commitment. And lastly, with that in commitment, right? You have commitment to obey the word of God because you love the Lord. You have commitment to fight sin. And you have to make a commitment to fight until the end. That's it. With charity, you can fight until the end. It all comes around, right? I love you, Lord. I'm going to follow you, and I'm going to obey your word. And I'm going to fight against sin. And I'm going to fight until the end. You know, pray that Lord comes right now, right? But if you tarry, Lord, until I die, I'm going to fight because I love you. I hope and pray that you and I will be found as a faithful servant, someone who loves the Lord and who's found as a fighting soldier of Jesus Christ when he comes back. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, many days we just go by living lackadaisically, lazy, filled with complacency, and don't realize that we're keep on losing the battle. And Father, I pray that with charity, we fight until the end. Lord God, help us make commitment, if we haven't already, to obey you and follow you. Obey your word because we love you, because you first loved us. You died for us, Lord God. And help us to make commitment to fight against sin, not just here and there, but all the time, 100%. And Lord, give us strength. With your grace and mercy, Lord God, help us to fight until the end. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, thank you, everyone.